I'd never met before. Yeah, that, I love that. I think that's the way church should be.
Good morning, everybody. Lovely to see everybody here this morning. Thank you for joining with us this morning, for taking the time to come on such an inclement day. It's miserable outside, isn't it? Yeah, wet and miserable and cold and dreary, but it's lovely and warm and cosy in here. So welcome to everybody as we join this morning here in Strain to worship God. If you're visiting with us, you're especially welcome. If you're visiting with us online, again, you are welcome as we join together this morning in praise and worship. And we trust that as we worship together, that you would know God's peace and blessing. I have a couple of announcements just to run through. The PowerPoint wouldn't work on the way in, so just let me highlight a few things for you. Just a little reminder that on Thursday this week, between 10 and 12, we have the drop-off for Food Bank. The items in particular they said they are looking for are sauces, gravy granules, tinned tomatoes, schlur, and a Christmas pudding. Surprise, surprise. So if you want to drop off any items, and any of those in particular, between now and Thursday, please feel free to do so. On Thursday, it is between 10 and 12. And a wee reminder as well from Sandra and from the rest of the team that your new FWO envelopes are in the welcome area. You might have already got them this morning, but please, as we leave this morning, go slowly, just so that the folks who are out there can catch if you've got envelopes to be picked up, and there's a few other bits and pieces there as well. Just a reminder as well that the Presbyterian Children's Society envelopes are in the pews. That little video that was playing a short time ago is in connection with that. And they can be dropped off at the drop-off, or you can bring them back on any Sunday, but please bring them back for Christmas Day then, if not. And then just at this stage to highlight that the church office will be closed from the 23rd of December until the 3rd of January. Those are all the announcements that I have. Anything else that comes up will be flashed up across our website and Facebook and social media as well, so keep an eye out for those. Now, I get to do the birthday blessings, and I have remembered them again today, which is great. So today is the 12th, so I do believe that we have somebody whose birthday is today, who's not with us today, but who will hear this later on. And I know I'll get into trouble for this, but I'll do it anyway. But today is Libby Orr's birthday, and Libby is 85 today. So happy birthday, Libby. And also for this incoming week, we have Mackenzie McCormick, we have Esme Moore, we have Holly Burgess, and we also have Ava Anketell. So happy birthday to all those folks. Let's pause, let's pray. Father, thank you again for this morning. Thank you as we gather as church family to praise and to worship you. And we do thank you for birthdays, for Libby and for Mackenzie, for Esme and for Holly and for Ava. Just ask that your blessing would continue to be upon them now and forevermore. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Just a little reminder that Sunday school is on today for the boys and girls. So you'll be able to go out to that. And it's also getting ready then for next Sunday, which is our carol service. So we are here at 11 o'clock for our all-age carol service. We're combining the two carol services together because of what's going on with COVID at this time. But please come together for our service of traditional and modern carols and of nine lessons as we gather next Sunday at 11 o'clock. Now let me read to you these verses. taking from the second half of Psalm 47. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. For God is the King over all the earth. Praise him with a psalm. God reigns over all the nations, sitting on his holy throne. The rulers of the world have gathered together with the people of God of Abraham. For all the kings of the earth belong to God. He is highly honored everywhere. We gather this morning to worship the one who is King of this world, King of this universe. Let us do so as we worship with our opening Christmas carol. Can we put it up on the screen? As with gladness men of old did the guiding star behold, as with joy they hailed its light, leading onward beaming bright, so most gracious God may we, led by you forever be. We come to worship the God who leads us, who guides us, who loves us. So let us stand and let us worship God this morning as we praise him. Let us come and let us worship God this morning in prayer. Let us pray. Father, this morning we thank you that we worship the one who is God of all the worlds, God of all the universe, the one who loves us and who cares for us, the one who is always by our side. Father, you are You are incredible. You are immeasurable. You know no limits, no bounds. Father, we just cannot truly grasp who and what you are. But we do know that you love us and care for us. We do know, especially at this time of Christmas, that you sent your Son, Jesus, to be our Savior. Father, we are flawed. We sin. We do things that we shouldn't do. We forget to do the things that we should do. Father, forgive us. Put your arms around us and hold us close. And Lord, this morning, that as we gather and worship you this morning, we just pray that we would truly know your presence, your peace, and your blessing. Continue with us now, Father, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Boys and girls, good morning. So I think these glasses must be really fogged up. They're affecting my hearing as well as my eyesight. Good morning. Ah, that's better now. Boys and girls, has anyone heard a baby cry this morning yet? No? We've got a little baby in church this morning. We want to say welcome to who is currently our youngest member of the church family. Everyone's sort of wondering now, if you turn your heads that direction, little Noah is sitting there at the minute, very comfortable on top of his mummy. So welcome this morning as Noah comes for his first service. It's great to have you here this morning. But boys and girls, Noah will not really be able to appreciate this year, but who's looking forward to Christmas and the presents? No? Yeah, oh, there's a few hands up there as well. Does anyone ever play the game Guess the Christmas Present whenever you see something wrapped up? Does anyone ever sneak down and try to rip the paper a little bit to see what's inside it beforehand? I think some of the adults might try and do that as well. Could you help me this morning, boys and girls? Could we play a game called Guess the Christmas Present? Is this on? Maybe it's just my hearing. Boys and girls, you think we could play that game? Which adults fancy playing a game this morning? Yeah? That's how you do it. Now, this is a really difficult thing to wrap. And as I'm going to keep it in the bag. And as I bring it out of the bag, shout out if you think you know what it is. Any guesses yet? Hang on, get a little bit more out. Maybe we get this side out. We get a teddy. Who said that? Feet kind of give it away, don't they?
It's really awkward to try and wrap a teddy to keep a teddy shape, so it is. So I think that might be a teddy bear. Might guess this next one. Now, let me see how I can hold it. If I hold it that way first, or maybe you should turn it that way. Boys and girls, any idea? Shout. A Toblerone. If that goes missing afterwards, I will come and hunt you down. It's my favourite chocolate. Now, you know what makes it really hard when you have a... It's whenever it's in a box like that, and you couldn't possibly tell from the box what it is. So what might you do to try and figure out what's inside the box? Give it a shake. I heard a voice from over here shouting Lego. I know who the big child is. Well done. Now, I wonder what sort of Lego it is. Anyone here like Star Wars Lego? Harry Potter Lego? I used to have space Lego many, many years ago, and technical Lego, and things like that, and build things. It doesn't really matter what's inside it, boys and girls, sure doesn't. The fact is, somebody has given you a present. And you know the really good thing about that present is it hasn't cost you any money. It's completely free. So your pocket money's still intact. But somebody has cared for you enough and loves you enough that they have given you a gift. Now, if it sits again underneath the Christmas tree, will it build itself? What do you have to do? Boys and girls, you're letting me down this morning. What do you have to do with the present? Open it and build it and accept it. It's the same with the present that God gives us. He has given us the best present of all. He has given us Jesus. Jesus who forgives us of our sins, who fixes our relationship with him. His gift is completely free. It doesn't cost us anything. All we have to do is accept it and accept Christ into our lives. Boys and girls, that's what you're going to hear about this morning as you go out to Sunday school. And I trust that as you go out, that you listen to the story, that you understand, and that in time, you accept Christ as your Savior. But let's praise God as we sing together. We've got a video for this morning. So let's put our video on, let's stand, and let's sing.
Born unto us this day, a Savior. Gifted from heaven to a manger. The hope of the world, a light for all mankind. All of the earth rejoice, it's Christmas time.
So lift up your voice and sing out his praise. It's Christmas, born is the King, rejoice in the day. It's Christmas, make a joyful sound. It's Christmas, let his praise resound. It's Christmas.
Goodwill to all the earth and peace divine. Rejoice, it's Christmas time, it's Christmas time.
So lift up your voice and sing out his praise. It's Christmas, born is the King, rejoice in the day. It's Christmas, make a joyful sound. It's Christmas, let his praise resound. It's Christmas, so lift up your voice and sing out his praise.
Boys and girls, do you want to go out to Sunday school? Slow and walk down from there, isn't it? Today is the third Sunday in Advent. I'm just going to light the candles here. Talk about how the candles represent hope, love, joy, and peace, with the center candle representing the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we're going to look at another one of those themes this morning. But as we come to do that, let us first of all read from God's word. So I'm going to read to you from Luke chapter 2. We're going to read together verses 1 to 20. This is a well-known passage. It is something that we use every Christmas time in the run-up to carol services and in carol services as well. But please just listen to the words. Try and hear them afresh this morning. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census would be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger because there was no room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angels, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem. This thing that has happened, God has told us about." So they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Amen. God would bless this reading of his word. Let us pause and pray. Father, this morning we are so grateful that we can read your word out loud, that here in a public place we can read the words that you have given to us so many years ago. We thank you for that freedom. And Lord, we pray that as we read your words, people would hear, would understand, and be transformed by it. And Father, we pray that as the live stream of this service goes out around the world, that again, that your word would be declared, and that people would hear it and understand it and accept it, accept the love which it brings. Father, you are a loving God who cares for each and every one of us. And we want others to know that, to know the good news about you. Lord, we thank you for those who each day give their lives in service for you. This morning, Father, we want to particularly remember the deaconesses of our church. Lord, they go through so much training. They go through times of placements as they seek your will, your guidance upon them. And then, Lord, you use them in incredible ways in different places. We pray for the deaconesses who work in churches. We pray for those who are in hospitals and hospices, those who work alongside school children. Lord, the work that those ladies do is incredible. And they do it because they love you, because you first loved them. And they feel that call upon their lives to serve you. So, Father, we thank you for all of our deaconesses. And Lord, we would ask that you would continue to work in the hearts of other ladies, that they would feel moved to follow you, that they would feel called to go into this line of service, that you would be able to use them in mighty and powerful ways in order to grow your kingdom, to strengthen your followers, to reach out to those who yet don't know you, that they would place their faith and trust in you. Lord, as we meet here this morning, please continue to be with our church family. We particularly remember this morning our young people who will be traveling home over these next few days. Keep them safe. And Lord, as they come home, may they be free of COVID and other infections so they'll be able to enjoy Christmas time with family and friends. And then, Lord, when the time comes, that you would take them back again to where they're going, whether it be work or university, that you would look after them and protect them. Father, for this morning, for the gifts and offerings which we have brought to you, we thank you for your blessing upon us. We ask that you would take our gifts and offerings, that you would use them to your glory and to your honor, that they be used to further your kingdom so that others may know about you. And Father, as we turn to your word now, help us to hear and understand. Help us to be encouraged and challenged. Help us to be drawn closer to you, we pray. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. We're just going to go up top. I'm going to start off this morning by asking a really personal question. I wonder if you grew up in the 60s or were a child of the 60s. Now, if you say yes to that, then you're dating yourself. But if you say yes to that as well, then you'll understand that symbol. So I wonder, were you a child of the 60s? A child of the time whenever the topic was peace. And that symbol, well, it means peace in so many different ways. It was used during the Vietnam War as peace because the people didn't want to be fighting. It was used as a symbol against nuclear armaments, for disarmament. But over the years, hasn't that symbol changed? Hasn't it become different things and different forms of peace? And other symbols for peace have sprung up as well. Maybe you recognize the famous sign used by Winston Churchill for victory, but how it's also become a symbol of peace. Within our country, even the word peace stirs emotions, doesn't it? Stirs our hearts, stirs feelings. And we all have an idea of what peace means to us. Now, if you turn to good old Wikipedia, you'll get a description, something like this. Peace is a concept of societal friendship and harmony in the absence of hostility and violence. It's a very, very detailed description of a worldview of peace. And yet, God a long time ago sent a message of peace. Let's see if we can get this. There we go. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those in whom his favor rests. Peace is a concept that we struggle with, isn't it? Peace is something which we so often have prayed for our land, for our country, for our world. And quite often we think of peace as that absence of war. Now, that war could be between countrymen, between neighbours. It could be between nations. Sometimes it's between friends. But peace for us as followers of Jesus means something completely different. I want you to try and put yourself back into the shoes of Mary and Joseph, back in that time so long ago, a time whenever the Romans ruled over the nation of Israel and a lot of the other known world at that time. Think of the Romans. Think of how they conquered lands. They were brutal. They did things which were unspeakable and unmentionable. And yet, in the midst of all of that, do not be afraid, Mary. Whenever Mary is told that she is going to bear a child, she is told, do not be afraid. How can I not be afraid? You might hear her ask. How can I not be afraid? Because I'm not yet married. How can I not be afraid? Because what will Joseph say when he realizes I'm pregnant? How can I not be afraid bringing a baby into this world? A world where there's turmoil, a world where there's fighting, a world where we don't know peace, we live as slaves and servants. Do not be afraid, Mary. How about whenever we are told at the beginning of Luke chapter 2, a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. Think of what that meant for those people at that time. Let's be honest, who here likes paying taxes? We don't, sure we don't. We begrudge it. The census was a way of the Roman Empire knowing exactly who was living in the boundaries, so they knew how much tax they could collect. They knew how many men there would be that they could conscript into armies. They knew how many slaves they potentially had. How those few people who ruled the lands could control everybody else. How could those people possibly have peace? How could they know what it was to have peace? Turn to the shepherds in our story. Those shepherds, as it said, lived on a hillside. They didn't have a roof over their heads. They lived with the sheep. They had to watch the sheep. They had a bad reputation. And the shepherds came into town, you knew about it. Well, you could smell them before you saw them. But they brought with them bad behavior. They didn't have a good rep. And yet, it was those shepherds that God chose to tell about the birth of his son. Those shepherds who sat quaking in fear when they saw an angel appear. And then even more fear when they saw a multitude of angels. Think of the wise men as they stood in front of Herod. Do you think they had a sense of fear in their heads, asking about where was the one born king of the Jews? They certainly did when they had that vision to go back by a different way. But you get the sense whenever they were in that court that they weren't really welcomed. They didn't have peace. And yet, when it came to that stable, when it came to that manger, there was peace. Now that's a really pretty picture, isn't it? It's a really nice picture, a really nice silhouette. Couldn't be farther from the truth. The manger, the stable was at the back of the house, maybe a cave. It was filled with animals. It was smelly, it was dirty. It also got packed with people that night. And yet in the midst of it, there was peace. Back to what the angels said to the shepherds. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace on those, to those on whom his favor rests. Wow. In the midst of a world of turmoil, in the midst of a world of slavery and oppression, there is peace. It's because God is there. There is peace because the presence of the Lord can be felt. There is peace because no matter what else is going on in the world around, God is with you. The shepherds must have felt that. Even though they were afraid, they realized they were chosen, that they were blessed, that they were special. And when the angel said, "Glory to God in the highest heaven," wow, these really are angels. They really are talking about Yahweh, about the one who made this world, the one who made us Israel. And he is with us, and we have his peace. Think of Mary. Think of the turmoil. First of all, she's told, she's chosen, she's going to carry a child. But how can I? I don't know a man. Joseph's going to divorce her then because she's got pregnant. And yet, in all those things, when that baby is born, in the turmoil of the stable, Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. From that line, you have a sense of peace with Mary. Peace because she knew God was with her. Peace because she knew that no matter what else was going on in that stable, God was by her side. God was holding her and holding her baby. You know, whenever we come to talk about peace in terms of the Christian follower or the Christian life, one who follows Jesus, peace for us means something completely different. Peace is not about going into a room and hearing a pin drop. Peace is not about how there is no war and fighting and squabbling between neighbors, between nations, between religions. It's not about that. Peace is knowing that you have God. Peace is knowing that no matter what else is going on in this world, you have an assurance that God loves you and cares for you, that God calls you his child. A peace that no matter what else is going on, you can always trust God. Paul talked about that peace many times whenever he wrote. Probably one of the best ones that we know of is the portion from Philippians 4, verse 7. "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus." Peace which transcends all understanding means that we can't understand that peace, but that we have that peace. Think of Stephen being stoned for what he said those few days after the Holy Spirit had arrived. When Stephen is chosen and Stephen speaks and people don't like what they hear, and as they are literally hurling rocks and stones at him, breaking bones and injuring him, he looks up and he sees heaven's gates open. And he sees Jesus standing ready to welcome him. At that point, he has a peace which transcends all understanding. A peace which comes from God. But don't just take Paul's word for it. Take Jesus' word for it. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Think of the peace accords which nations have signed over the years. Think of peace treaties which have been agreed and then broken. Think of how nations one day shake hands and the next day shake fists at each other. Think of how one moment we're best friends with a nation, and then they're blockading us because they don't like what we've done. That's not peace. That's not knowing the peace which Christ gives. The peace which Jesus gives is knowing just how much he loves you. The peace that Jesus gives you is knowing that he came at Christmas time, born as a baby, to go to Calvary to die for your sins. Peace is knowing that that gift from God is free, and that you don't have to be good enough to take that gift. You just have to take it and unwrap it and let Jesus into your life. Let him change you. Let him draw close to you. And then you have his peace. You have his assurance. You have his guarantee. You have the grace of God. That's what true peace is. You know, right now, where we all sit, we all have things which trouble us. We all have things that worry us. We all come bearing a burden. God knows that burden. God knows what you are struggling with. And he still gives you his peace. In the midst of those struggles, you can know God is with you. But only if you accept his gift. Only if you accept what is free and let him in. And what's more, what good is a present you get at Christmas if you only play for it for a few days and then set it to one side? You want something that you can use all the time, don't you? Something which is constantly with you, something which you get constant enjoyment and pleasure out of. Well, that's the gift of Christ. He wants you to constantly enjoy his presence, his company, enjoy his leadership, enjoy his love. Enjoy whenever he corrects you, yes, because he puts you back on the right path. Enjoy how he guides and leads you. Enjoy how he provides for you. Enjoy how he knows everything about you and still holds you close, still has his arms around you, still loves you. If we unwrap that present, we have true peace. Now, I don't know about you, but I want that peace every day, every minute of every day. I want that peace. I crave that peace. And I accept it because I accept Christ. Have you accepted Christ? Have you, first of all, unwrapped that gift? And if you have, do you treat it as a special gift? Do you only play with it occasionally? Do you only bring God out of the cupboard on a Sunday to come to church and enjoy his company? Or do you let God influence you each day of the week? Those candles down there, if I don't blow them out, very soon they'll go out. The wax will run out. God's love never runs out. Never let that light go out. His light shines forever. And he wants it to shine in us every minute of every day. Will we let him? That's the challenge that we face today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your peace. Peace that we don't understand, but peace that we have freely through you. Lord, if there's anybody here this morning who as yet doesn't have your peace, may they open their life to you. Lord, may they realize it's not complicated. They just need to let you in and see how your peace will flow through their life. Lord, as we go into this week, May we carry your peace with us as we meet others, as we encounter others, as we have interactions. May that peace from you flavor those interactions. May we share that peace with others, that they too will want your peace and accept you. Father, thank you. And be with us now, we pray. Amen. Let us continue to worship God as we sing together the words of our closing hymn, Good Christian, All Rejoice. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and His peace be with us now and forevermore, we pray. Amen. Folks, thanks for being here this morning. It's been great to have you join with us. Don't forget that next Sunday is our carol service, so please come out and join us for that. It will be a slightly longer service because of what we're doing, but please join with us. As you leave the building now, again, we'll go out the two sides, just out through the doors behind, but please take your time in that. If you haven't received an envelope yet this morning, more than likely there's going to be an envelope waiting for you in the welcome area. So if we can just go out slowly, giving each other that bit of space, we can make sure we can get these all distributed. But thank you, take care, and God bless.